Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamu alaikum. Welcome back to your online lecture series of EE314 Measurements and Instrumentation. This is the first lecture of week 12, your lecture number 37, and this is the second part on our series on temperature measurement. And in this lecture, we are going to discuss about the remaining types of temperature sensors, continuing from our previous lecture, and they will include resistive sensors, solid state sensors, and some other types. And mainly we'll focus on the design problems for the signal conditioning circuits, keeping in view the real life applications. So let's get started. Okay, so continuing from our previous lectures, we have already covered the RTDs and thermoelectric effects, the thermocouples, and now we are going to discuss about semiconductive temperature sensors. There will be two types of semiconductive sensors. The first ones are thermistors, who have a negative temperature coefficient and their resistance decreases with the increase in temperature. While the second type of semiconductive sensors are solid state sensors that are some sort of a solution on a chip, and they provide linear voltage output with respect to change in temperature. So what are thermistors? In contrast to metals, electrons in semiconductor materials are bound to each molecule with sufficient strength that no conduction electrons are contributed from the valence band to the conduction band. The semiconductor becomes a better conductor as the temperature is increased, and so its resistance decreases with increasing temperature, thus having a negative temperature coefficient. The changes in resistance of approximately 10% per degree centigrade are not common, that is not bad. Thus, a thermistor with a nominal resistance of 10 kilo ohm at some temperature may change by 1 kilo ohm for 1 degree centigrade change in temperature, and that is a huge plus in terms of sensitivity. So they have a very, very good sensitivity. Their construction is based on semiconductive materials. Because thermistor is a bulk semiconductor, it can be fabricated in many forms. Thus, the common forms include discs, beads, and rods, varying in size from a bead 1 millimeter in diameter to a disc several centimeters in diameter and several centimeters in width. The temperature range in which these kinds of temperature sensors can operate and sense temperature effectively is usually lower than the other counterparts, and it depends upon the type of material that is being used. So in general, there are three range limitation effects: melting or deterioration of the semiconductor, deterioration of the encapsulated material, and insensitivity at higher temperatures. So this means that even though thermistors offer a very high sensitivity and a very high accuracy in return, the range they offer for temperature measurement is usually a smaller range at lower temperatures. The response time of thermistor depends principally on the quantity of material present in and the environment. Thus, for the smallest bead, a response time of about a half second is typical. So they have a fairly good response time, but again, it depends upon the size of material. Smaller the size, better the response time. And finally, talking about the signal conditioning, because a thermistor exhibits such a large change in resistance with temperature, there are many possible circuit applications. And because these devices are resistive devices, we can use a voltage divider as well, and any other circuit that converts resistance into voltage output. So care must be taken while using thermistors as temperature sensors, because when we use a resistive device as temperature sensors, current flows through that and self-heating effect has to be considered. A resistance of this thermistor is 3.5 kilo ohms at 20 degree centigrade and a slope of 10% per degree centigrade. The dissipation constant PD is 5 milliwatt per degree centigrade that results in self-heating, and it is proposed to use this thermistor to provide a voltage range of 5 volt at 20 degree centigrade. So let's see if we use a voltage divider to convert this resistance change into a change in voltage. And as the resistance of this sensor is 3.5 kilo ohms at 20 degrees centigrade, we have to choose this second resistor, that is a fixed resistor whose value is comparable to your actual sensor resistance. So let's use a 3.5 kilo ohm fixed resistor here as well, and let's use a power supply of 10 volts. So this means that at 20 degrees centigrade the resistance was 3.5 kilo ohms, this RT. So this 10 volts will be divided and the output voltage will be 5 volts at 20 degrees Celsius. And that was one of the requirements of our circuit. So without using any op amps or any active components, we have achieved one of the goals of getting a 5 volt output at 20 degrees Celsius. So let's keep our calculations simple, and now let's calculate how much power is dissipated across this resistor. So at 20 degrees Celsius, this RT is 3.5 kilo ohm. This means that a current of approximately 10 over 7 kilo ohms, that comes out to be approximately 1.43 milliamperes. And to find the power dissipation across this resistor, we can find the formula of I square R, and this means that a power of 7.143 milliwatts is dissipated across this resistor at 20 degrees centigrade due to self-heating. And we remember from our previous lectures that the delta T, the rise in temperature due to self-heating, is calculated using this formula P over PD, where P is the power dissipated in across that sensor and PD is the dissipation constant, that is 5 milliwatt per degree centigrade. So this gives us a delta T of approximately 1.42 degrees Celsius. This means that if we simply use a potential divider with a fixed resistor in series and a 10 volt power supply, error in temperature due to self-heating would be approximately 1.5 degrees at 20 degrees Celsius, and it will change as the temperature changes. Now let's find out how significant is this 1.42 degrees. We are given with this value of slope the change in resistance of this sensor per degrees centigrade. So 10% of 3.5 kilo ohms means approximately 350 ohms. And for 1.42 degrees, let's add around half of this value to this. So this means that around 520 ohms resistance will change due to this self-heating. So the resistance of this temperature sensor that was supposed to be at 3.5 kilo ohms at 20 degrees Celsius will not be at 3.5 kilo ohms right now, but it would be less than that, and it would be around 2.98 kilo ohms instead of 3.5 kilo ohms. And using this value in the potential divider, we get the V out not equal to 5 volts but equal to around 4.6 volts. So this means that previously we were thinking that using a simple voltage divider we can get a 5 volt output, the desired output at 20 degrees Celsius, but due to the self-heating that 5 volt was shifted from 5 to 4.6. so our target was not achieved using this simple circuit, and the results are unsatisfactory. And this means that we have to be very, very careful while designing the signal conditioning circuits for this type of resistive sensors, and we have to carefully consider the effect of self-heating so that our targets are not deviated much from our required values. Okay, so the second type of semiconductive sensors are solid-state temperature sensors. Many integrated circuit manufacturers are now making solid state temperature sensors for consumer and industrial applications, and these devices offer voltages that vary linearly with temperature over a specified range. So the circuit a part of the signal conditioning circuit is fabricated on chip along with the sensor. And they function by exploiting the temperature sensitivity of doped semiconductor devices such as diodes and transistors. One common version is essentially a Zener diode in which the Zener voltage increases linearly with temperature. We all know that. So the Zener diode is used as a temperature sensor, and it is connected with a fixed series resistor to get a temperature VT, that and the voltage output that is a function of changing temperature. Again, self-heating must be considered, even though they are not resistive sensors, but because they dissipate power as given by the Zener voltage times the operating current. So some current is passing through the Zener diode and a voltage is dropped across this element. So if there is a current passing through a device and a voltage is dropped across the device, that device will dissipate power, no matter if it is a resistive device or a diode or whatever. So in this figure 16, the circuit has a series resistor of 510 ohms, and we can calculate the Zener current as 5 minus 3.516 over 510 is equal to 0.0029 amperes. And this will give us a power dissipation of 10.2 milliwatts across this diode. And as we saw previously, that in case of semiconductors, usually the power dissipation constant is around 5 milliwatt per degree centigrade, so there can be a 2 degree centigrade self-heating error, and we do not want that 2 degree Celsius error in our delicate applications. If we try to operate this sensor at a lower current than this one, we can increase this resistance and we can cut down the current passing through this Zener diode. So if we increase this resistance by 4 times, the current will drop by 4 times and the power dissipated will drop by 4 times, and this error of 2 degrees Celsius will drop by 4 times, from 2 degrees to 0.5 degrees Celsius. That is quite acceptable. So far we have completed the RTDs, thermistors and thermocouples. So let's quickly discuss about the thermal expansion, and then we will go through the remaining types of temperature sensors. Temperature sensors that work on the principle of thermal expansion include solids, liquids and gases. So in case of solids, we have a bimetallic strip in which there are two metals or two solid materials that when heated expand, and they expand with a different ratio. So this means that their thermal conductivity constants are different from each other, but they are tightly bound together. So if this metal tries to, the lower metal tries to expand more than the upper metal, the bimetallic strip will bend. And this is the basic working principle of these kind of sensors. So these sensors can be used to open or close the switches or contacts, or to actuate an on-off mechanism. So this means that they can be used as actuators, as well as sensors, as well as switches. And if we connect a dial, a scaled calibrated dial and a needle to this this bimetallic strip, it can also be used to tell the temperature. And further, if we want to not just turn on or off a device, but if we want to control the intensity of heat, for example, there is a gas valve here and a gas pipe here, and this valve is connected with this metallic strip. So if this strip moves up or down, this valve will be partially opened or partially closed, thus allowing a different amount of gas to pass through, and thus controlling the intensity of heat that is controlled by the supply of this gas. So the bimetallic strips are widely used in our daily use appliances, household and industrial appliances, and they are a very good system in themselves, as they can be used as actuators as well as sensors. Then in case of liquid-based thermal expansion temperature sensors, we have liquid expansion thermometers. Whenever material that is affected by the temperature is a liquid, and the most common example is a mercury thermometer. where the when the mercury is heated, it expands in volume, and it can the expansion in volume is observed as a rise in the level of mercury across a calibrated scaled capillary. And then if the material that we are using for temperature sensing that expands due to the change in temperature, increasing temperature, is a gas, so we have vapor pressure thermometers, and they work on the same principle that when a gas is heated, it tries to expand, but if we don't give any room for expansion of the gas, the pressure inside that container increases, and that increase in pressure can be calibrated against the change in temperature. So these are the three different forms of thermal expansion based temperature sensors. And finally, we will discuss about the remaining types of temperature sensors that include the radiative heat emission. The radiative heat can be captured using infrared thermometers or thermal cameras. The radiative heat emits some radiation that cannot be captured by the human eye. It is not inside the visible spectrum, but outside the visible spectrum, the heat is emitted in the form of some radiative energy, and that energy can be captured using special types of cameras, and that can be converted into color scales to differentiate between the different temperatures. Then we have some resonant frequency change temperature sensors. For example, you are all familiar with quartz crystals that are used as crystal oscillators in your microprocessors and microcontrollers, but they provide a very accurate frequency, a resonant frequency at a fixed temperature. If the temperature changes, the resonant frequency changes, and that change in frequency can be scaled against the change in temperature. So those oscillators, those resonators can be used as temperature sensors. Similarly, we have already discussed this sensitivity of fiber optic devices, the fiber optic material, the material from which that optical fiber is made, its properties depend upon the temperature. And if the temperature changes, the properties of light passing through that fiber can change, and those properties can include the intensity of light, dilation or delay, the angle or the phase at which the light is entering or leaving that optical fiber, and so on. And that change in the properties of light can be scaled across the change in temperature. Then we have some color change based temperature sensors. Those are mostly used in chemical and food industries and medicine industries, and they work on the principle that when a certain chemical is heated, it changes color. Sometimes it is reversible, sometimes it is not reversible. So it is not quantifying the change in temperature, but it is just indicating that the temperature has raised from a certain level or a certain threshold. And lastly, we have the change of state of material, in which the material changes its state due to the change in temperature. For example, there are some special alloys that are solid at room temperature, but when the temperature is further increased, maybe beyond 70 degrees, they convert from solid to liquid, and as those alloys are conductive, they can be used in switches. So these are the 10 types of temperature sensors that are currently being used in our industry and in our household appliances. If we see, we are getting the change in resistance, increase in resistance with increase in temperature, decrease in resistance with increase in temperature. The magnitude of resistance is very small here. The magnitude of change in resistance is very large here. Then we are getting the voltage output, and then we are getting a mechanical output. So effectively, if we just ignore temperature as a parameter and consider any other type of sensor, can be strain sensors or flow sensors or pressure sensors or light sensors or any type of sensor for any different parameter, what will be the output of that sensor? That all those outputs are covered in detail in these temperature sensor based problems that any sensor has an output in the form of change in current, resistance, voltage, capacitance, or some physical quantity. And all those quantities are being covered in detail in case of these temperature sensors. So the advantage of studying these temperature sensors in detail is that if we consider each and every point related to different types of outputs of a sensor, let it be temperature sensor, we can use those rules and use that knowledge that we gained in developing signal conditioning for these type of sensors for any type of sensors and not just temperature sensors, because we are not interested in which parameter was changing our resistance. We are interested in the change in resistance and to convert that change in resistance to a change in voltage between a certain level and to avoid the self-heating. So that change in resistance can be due to anything, and we don't care about that. So if we develop and if we understand the working principles and the rules that are used to develop signal conditioning for temperature sensors, we are almost done with all types of sensors that are available in the market for any different physical parameter. So that's why we are focusing on each and every type with so much details. Let's go through some design considerations. So the first thing is to identify the nature of measurement. And this includes the nominal values and the range of temperature measurement, the physical conditions or the environment where the measurement is to be made, and the required speed of measurement is also important. Because in case of some real-time control systems, you need your sensor to have a very fast response time and any other features that must be considered. Then in the second point, we have to identify the required output signal. In most applications, the output, the required output will either be a standard 4 to 20 milliampere current or a voltage that is scaled to represent the range of temperature in the measurement. There may be further requirements related to isolation, output impedance, and other factors. So all those required output signal conditions have to be considered. And thirdly, we have to select an appropriate sensor that meets the requirements that have been identified in our first two steps. In addition to them, we have to consider the signal conditioning requirements of our interface circuits or the system in which we are going to employ that sensor. But that is secondary, because we can add some further signal conditioning circuits and signal conditioning systems to satisfy the requirements of our existing systems and to make our output signal compatible with our existing system. And lastly, we have to design the required signal conditioning circuit or a system and use the signal conditioning techniques that we have developed previously. So these are the four basic design considerations that have to be carefully considered before designing the signal conditioning circuits. So let's try to implement these four conditions using some design examples. All right, so let's get started with the design examples. So this is the example number 17 of your textbook. The statement is, a type J thermocouple is to be used in a measurement system that must provide an output of 2 volts at 200 degrees. A solid state temperature sensor will be used to provide reference temperature compensation. And that solid state sensor that will be used for temperature compensation has three terminals. One is the supply voltage, one is ground, and the third one is the output voltage. And that output voltage varies as 8 millivolts per degree Celsius. To understand this problem, let me make a simple figure. So this is your thermocouple, and this is your reference temperature. And here, we are not fixing this reference node at a fixed temperature. Either fix this at a 0 degrees Celsius or to fix it at a 20 degrees Celsius and then subtract the reading of that voltage at that particular temperature manually from the reading of this thermocouple output, what we will do is we are going to install another temperature sensor here, and output of this temperature sensor will be added to the output of this thermocouple. There are few things that need to be kept in mind. So the thermocouple tables that we have for the type JAK or any other type of thermocouple all have their reference temperature at 0 degrees Celsius, and the V out for all those sensors is basically corresponding to the del T. For example, if the V 20 or if the V 50 is given in the table for a J-type thermocouple, this means that del T was equal to 50 degrees, and that del T means 50 minus 0, and this 0 was your reference temperature. What if my reference temperature changed from 0 to 20 degrees, for instance? Now, when the temperature is 50 degrees, this means that del V will correspond to the del T, and that del T will be 50 minus 20, and that is equal to 30 degrees Celsius. So this means that the voltage output for now in front of the 50 degrees corresponds to the voltage output of a temperature difference of 30 degrees. And this means that the voltage at whatever reference temperature is produced has to be added to the voltage of this thermocouple output. That is the first thing. The second thing is that the voltage output of this reference temperature sensor, has to have the same transfer function, the same change in voltage of that J-type thermocouple. So even if this temperature is changing, if this reference temperature sensor and this thermocouple have the same transfer function or the same relation of voltage versus temperature, they can be added and a real-time compensation will be done. But if we go to the thermocouple tables, type J thermocouple is being used for this experiment. So we have to find out that what is the slope or what is the mathematical relationship of the voltage output of this thermocouple with this temperature, and how that can be found out. You just take two different readings of temperature and two corresponding readings of voltages, 5.268 minus 0 over 100. So that would become 5.268 microvolts per degrees Celsius. This means that the transfer function of this thermocouple is 53 microvolts per degrees Celsius, while the relationship of this reference temperature sensor with temperature is 8 millivolt per degrees Celsius. They are not equal. To make them equal, let's find out by which factor they are different. So that is 8 millivolts, that is 8000 microvolts, and divide it by 53 microvolts, and that comes out to be 151. So what we have to do is we have to divide the output of this reference temperature sensor by 151, or we have to multiply the output of this thermocouple by 151 to make them equal. So let's multiply it. Let's multiply it with a gain of 151 and then let's add them. So this output and this reference output are added. Now what's happening here is that this 53 microvolt per degree centigrade is being converted into an output voltage multiplied by 151. And now this is 8 millivolt per degree centigrade, and this is also 8 millivolt per degree Celsius. And these two outputs are added. So whatever the difference in reference temperature will be, the voltage due to their difference will be added. Why it needs to be added, we just discussed that. Let me put it another way. For example, if your temperature was 50 degrees and your reference was 0 degrees, so a 0 will be here and the delta T will be 50 degrees. So the voltage corresponding to 50 degrees will be here and that will be multiplied and will be converted into this 8 millivolt per degree centigrade. So 8 into 50 is 400 millivolts will be produced at this point if it is 8 millivolt per degrees, or this is 53 millivolt per degree centigrade, 53 microvolts. So 53 micro into 50 is 2650 microvolts, and that into 151, that is 400,000 microvolts or 400 millivolts. So 400 millivolts will be produced for a if your reference was at 0 and your thermocouple was at 50 degrees. Now, what if your reference changed from 50 to 20 degrees Celsius? Now, the del T is 30 degrees here. And the voltage this thermocouple will be producing will be for 30 degrees, not for 50 degrees. So, 53 into 30 is 1590 microvolts into 151, and that is 240 millivolts. But we needed a 400 millivolt because 0 was the reference, the actual reference, but our reference now changed. So how much voltage this will be, this reference sensor will be producing will be 160 millivolts. And these two will be added to get a 400 millivolt output. So the actual desired value of 400 millivolts is already there, and the reference is the reference compensation is being done in real time automatically based on this solid state sensor. So the rest of the thing is fairly simple. Now we have to convert this output so that we get a 2 volt output at 200 degrees Celsius. So let's find out how much voltage is being produced here at 200 Celsius, 200 degrees, and that is 8 into 200, and that is around 1.6 volts. We are getting 1.6 volts at 200 degrees Celsius. But what do we need? 2 volts. So we can divide this 1.6 and 2 by 1.6, and the gain is 2 over 1.6 is equal to 1.25. So we can further give this a gain of 1.25, and our output will be 2 volts at 200 degrees Celsius as per requirements. So this was a fairly simple problem, and but at the same time it was a fairly interesting problem that solves the issue of this reference temperature or reference compensation, or to keep this node at a fixed temperature. Usually it is very difficult to maintain a fixed temperature. So what we do is we do not put it in an ice bath, but rather we install a temperature sensor here and we use it for compensation and just put this reference temperature at room temperature, reference node at room temperature, that is around 15 to 25 to 30 degrees, and this thermocouple is at a much higher temperature, so a voltage difference is being produced, and the compensation with respect to zero reference is done in real time. So let's move on to the next example. In this one, we have to develop a system that turns on an LED when the temperature in a chamber reaches 10 degrees with an acceptable error of plus minus 0.5 degrees. But now the LED should not turn off until the temperature reaches below 8 degrees. So this is a hysteresis comparator based problem. For the temperature sensor, we are using a thermistor whose resistance is 10 kilo ohms at 10 degrees, and it has a slope of negative 5% per per degrees centigrade. This is -5% not 0.5%. And the dissipation constant PD is 5 milliwatt per degree centigrade. So we have some information given in this statement. The first one is that we have to use a hysteresis comparator, number one. So here is a hysteresis comparator and here is your V reference. The second thing is the change in temperature of this your sensor is change in resistance. So it is a resistive sensor. And to convert resistance into voltage, what we can do? We can use a simple potential divider. So here is our potential divider. And let's connect it with our hysteresis comparator. Now we have to select. So now we have to select which one of these is the sensor and which one of these is the fixed resistor. And I will select the top one as the sensor resistance, RT, and this one as a fixed resistor. And let's power it with a 5 volt. Why I have selected this one the top one as our sensor is because the sensor has a negative temperature coefficient of resistance. So when the temperature increases, the resistance decreases. And when the resistance decreases, our output should increase because when our temperature increases, we want to turn on the alarm. We don't want to turn off the alarm. We have to turn on the alarm. So our comparator output should be equal to 1 at a higher temperature, at a lower resistor. And at a lower resistor, if your resistor is in the upper part of your voltage divider, your resistance will increase with decreasing temperature because your potential will be dropped across this fixed resistor. Now we have some values given to us for the for this RT. So this means that at 8 degrees Celsius and at 10 degrees Celsius, the values of RT are equal to, this is 10 kilo ohms and this is 11 kilo ohms. Temperature is lower, resistance is higher. And how did this 11 come? Because it had a slope of negative 5% per degree centigrade. 5% of 10 is 0.5 kilo ohms for per degree centigrade. This means that for a difference of 2 degrees, it would be 1 kilo ohm per 2 degrees Celsius, and that's how this 11 came. Now coming to the second part, that is this plus minus 5 degrees centigrade, that is the allowable error. And from where that error is coming? Because of the power dissipation across this resistor. So to be on the safe side, let's take this error to be plus minus 0.25 degrees Celsius, just to be on the safe side. And this plus minus 0.25 degrees is your del T. Your del T is P over PD, and that is equal to P over 5 milliwatt per degrees Celsius. This del T is 0.25 degrees Celsius. We are just being cautious. We could have taken the 0.5 degrees, but we are just being cautious and we are taking half of the value of our allowable error. So this means that your power dissipated across this resistor, the maximum allowable power dissipation comes out to be 1.25 milliwatt. And with that, this P is equal to I square R. So we can find the value of this I for the lower value of resistance, and the lower value of resistance is 10K. So 1.25 milliwatt is equal to I squared into 10 kilo ohms, and which gives us I max equal to 0.354 milliamperes. Now this is the maximum allowable current that can pass through your sensor's resistance, and in that case your power dissipation will result in error no more than 0.25 degrees Celsius. And now this current will help us to find out the value of our fixed resistor, this R. How it can help us? Let's take this I to be equal to 0.35 milliamperes. And with a 5 volt supply, this V is equal to IR will be followed. I is 0.35 milliamperes. This R is 10 kilo ohms. So this V comes out to be 3.5 volts. And if our R is 10 kilo ohms and our V is 3.5 kilo ohms, then we can easily find out what is the value of R2. And our R2 is equal to the V supply minus V over I. And that is 5 minus 3.5 volts over 0.35 milliampere. This means that our R2 comes out to be 4.28 kilo ohms or approximately 4.3 kilo ohms. So this R is 4.3 kilo ohms. Now that we have the values of both these resistors for 8 degrees and for 10 degrees, let's find out the value of V in. So at 8 degrees, V in would be equal to 1.41 volts, and at 10 degrees, V in would be equal to 1.5 volts. And the delta V, that is equal to 0.09 volts, and that is equal to negative RF over RI, not negative, that would be equal to RF over RI into V out, where V out is again 5 volts. So this means that your RF over RI should be equal to 0.018. So just select a value of this RF and RI so that their ratio becomes 0.018. So let's choose RF equal to 500 kilo ohms and RI equal to 9 kilo ohms. And finally, the only remaining thing is this VR. So your system or your alarm should turn on when the temperature reaches 10 degrees Celsius, and when the temperature will reach 10 degrees Celsius, when the voltage becomes 1.5 volts. So this VR should become 1.5 volts. You can supply it using another voltage divider. So this is an example that combines a temperature sensor in a hysteresis comparator, and it is used to turn on or off an alarm with a certain defined offset. So let's start our final design problem. The problem states that in this figure, an industrial process is represented. Vapor is flowing in from this side and flowing out from this side, and this temperature transducer is measuring the temperature of this vapor. And the vapor temperature ranges from 50 to 80 degrees Celsius. Below that is another liquid at 100 degrees Celsius, and it is being heated, and due to heating this level can rise, and if this level rises, it will come in direct contact with this temperature sensor and the temperature will become 100 degrees. But at this point, an alarm should go off. The requirement is to measure this temperature and output it as a voltage ranging from 0 to 2 volts, while the error should not exceed plus minus 1 degree Celsius. So this plus minus 1 degree Celsius error is again due to self-heating. It is not mentioned anywhere that what kind of temperature transducer is being used. So it is part of the design now that which temperature sensor we are going to use. So let's start and try to solve this problem. As this is a case of a mid-range temperature measurement from 50 to 100 degrees Celsius, not very high temperature, we can use a resistive temperature detector, RTD, because the output of an RTD will be fairly linear in the range from 30 to 100 degrees. And while choosing an RTD, we have to see the specifications of that RTD, and that are given here. The resistance at the midpoint temperature between 50 and 80 degrees, the midpoint is 65 degrees Celsius, and the resistance at that point is 150 ohms. The value of alpha, the coefficient of change in resistance, is 0.004 per degree centigrade, and the power dissipation constant is 30 milliwatt per degree centigrade. So, using the equation, the linear approximation for RTD, let's first find out the resistance at various temperatures of our interest, 50, 80, and 100 degrees Celsius. So, RT is equal to RT naught into 1 plus alpha into T minus T naught, where RT naught is 150 ohms, alpha is 0.004, T is 50, 80, and 100, and T naught is 65. So, that gives us the resistance output of our RTD at 50, 80, and 100 degrees to be 141, 159, and 171 ohms. Now, coming to the power dissipation, we know that del T is equal to P over PT, where del T, allowed error, is 1 degree Celsius. The power dissipation constant is 30 milliwatt per degree centigrade. So, this gives us the maximum allowable power dissipation in that sensor to be 30 milliwatt, and that is equal to I square R, the current flowing through that sensor into the resistor. And which value of resistor? The minimum value of resistor. So here, this should not be 159, this should be 141, and the current should be calculated according to that. Maximum current will flow when the resistance is minimum, so that is a mistake. So let's assume that the current comes out to be 13.7 milliamperes even after putting 141. That wouldn't be, but let's assume any value of current. Now that current is used to find the voltage drops across these resistors when this current is flowing through them. So we can use a bridge circuit or we can use a potential divider. But which one would be better? A potential divider would not be suitable in this case, as the change in resistance is not very high. We can see here the change in resistance is only in tens of ohms, not in kilo ohms or hundreds of ohms. So the sensitivity or resolution of a bridge will be much, much greater as compared to a simple potential divider. So let's use a bridge circuit for that. So this means that in case of a bridge circuit, your circuit would be like this, and it will be powered up, let's say, through 5 volts. So this is your RTD. We will choose the values of these resistors accordingly, according to this one. So the minimum value of RTD was 141 ohms. So let's choose this to be 141 ohms because we want our bridge to be nulled at this temperature to get a zero output at 50 degrees Celsius, because our final required output is from 0 to 2 volts. So if we keep our output to be 0 for 50 degrees, that would be easier for us to handle in the signal conditioning circuit later. So let's take it 141. Now calculate the voltage at 141, 159, and 175. And then calculate the voltage drop across this resistor when a 13.7 milliampere current flows into 13.7 milliampere. So a voltage of 2.17 volts. Again, that would be 141. So some voltage Vx would be dropped across this, and then 5 minus Vx would be the voltage drop across this resistor over R is equal to I, and this is the I, this is the Vx, and R will be calculated this resistor, just like in our previous example. So this gives us R2 to be 276 6.5 ohms. So let's take this one also as 206.5 ohms to balance the bridge. He has taken it to be 220 ohms. So we will take both these values as same and both these values as same. So now our bridge circuit is complete and it is giving a 0 volt output at 50 degrees centigrade. See here, R3 is 141, R4 is RTD, and both of them, R2 and R1, are 220. Here, R1 and R2 are 220. So just what you have to do is you have to replace this 159 by 141 because that would give you the maximum current. So at 50 degrees, the del V should be 0, and that is the case. At 80 degrees, the del V will be calculated by putting this RTD as 159, and the del V comes out to be 0.1447 volts, and at 100 degrees, it comes out to be 0.2338 volts. This is our range of temperature measurement from 50 to 80 degrees, and we have to convert it from 0 volts to 2 volts. This is already at 0 volts, so no offset is necessary. This should be 2 volts. So 2 over 0.1447 should be equal to the gain supplied to this differential output of this bridge circuit. And that is what we are doing. 2 over 0.1147, the gain is 13.8. So we have 220 ohms here, 220 ohms here, RTD here, and 141 ohms here. So we are giving it a gain of 1 here, then this has to be 138 kilo ohms and this has to be 10 kilo ohms to give it a gain of 13.8, and this V out will range from 0 to 2 volts. But when the temperature rises further to 100 degrees Celsius, this would become 3.23 volts. So a reference of 3.23 volts as written here should be provided to a comparator, and that is connected to an alarm. So here is an alarm system also, and here is your temperature output in terms of voltage, required voltage range also. And there are hundreds of types, other types of examples that are related to these sensors, but the basic principle and the basic approach remains the same. Whether you have to see whether you have a resistive sensor or a voltage based sensor, and what is the required output, and what is the range of the required output, and what is the maximum allowable error, and then you can start designing your signal conditioning circuit. So that's it for your lectures on temperature sensors and effectively your signal conditioning circuit design for your overall sensors. In next lecture, we are going to discuss about other types of sensors for other physical parameters, and we will keep doing the design examples related to that. And you will notice that they will all follow the same pattern as we discussed in these last three design examples related to temperature sensor, as we don't really care what is here, whether it this R is sensing temperature or strain or light or any other quantity. So the circuit will remain the same, or and the approach will remain the same. So see you in the next lecture, inshallah. Till then, stay safe, take care, Allah Hafiz.